My life's journey.
Yeah.
Well, that starts when I'm born, right?
Yeah.
1947.
Ooh.
That's when I was born. And I was born to a 19-year-old mother.
Mm.
And 28-year-old father. And so my first real friend was my mother.
Mm.
Because she was just a child herself. My earliest recollections was my mother teaching me how to spell. And she was my first playmate.
Mm.
Right. And music came into my life in a big way when I was in kindergarten. The first song that touches my heart was a song by Danny Kaye and his daughter. It was called Little Child. It was also known as Daddy Dear. And that came out in around 1951 or 52. So I would have been about 4 or 5 years old.
Children could fly, there'd be no need for birds. And I cry, little one, 'cause I'm touched by your words.
And music came,
don't be sad, Daddy.
Came into my life in a big way when I was in kindergarten. Because I loved singing so much. And so when my parents came for their first PTA meeting, right, the parent-teachers meeting, the teacher said, you know, your son has a really, really fine voice for such a young boy. And he seems to have a real talent for that. And the next thing I knew, my father had found me these great teachers in New York City. And I was off studying music. And a few years later into drama school, studying with private teachers who were very, very good. And so there was always, music was always there in my life. And when we would have dinner at my, when we would have dinner at my grandmother's house, all my uncles would sing. And then they'd let me be the judge as to who was the winner.
Yeah.
So I had one uncle who loved Tony Bennett. He would sing like Tony Bennett.
Really?
And he would do a Tony Bennett song.
Like what?
Like Rags to Riches. My other uncle sang just like Nat King Cole. And he would sing Mona Lisa. And my other uncle loved Dean Martin, so he would sing songs by Dean Martin. Like, You're Nobody Till Somebody Loves Me. But then as the years passed, I began getting, I got the Broadway part, I got an understudy part in a Broadway play at 10.
Mm-hmm.
So after 5 years of studying drama and voice, I landed the understudy job at Fanny.
What was the song that you sang? That you were singing that?
Love thy, love, honor thy mother, love thy parents. Gotta check that out. Just barely. 78, it's 66 years ago.
Remember the grown-ups, a difficult stage of life. They're apt to be nervous and overexcited, confused from the daily storm and strife.
Wow.
So Fanny turned out to be a big disappointment because I was supposed to take over the lead when the show went touring, and then they were supposed to make the movie in Hollywood, and my agent had gotten me, because that's where the show was going to go, into Canada, across the country, and then in California. That's where I was supposed to get screen tested. So at 10 o'clock at night, the night before, we were leaving on the train, 6 in the morning, because the show was going to open in Boston. And a Western Union man, they used to call them the Western Union men. So you would telegraph, and then a person would come and deliver the telegram to you. And so after all of my relatives had been over the house to say goodbye, I had been out of school now. I'd been going to actors school by Lincoln Center. There was an acting school there. I think it might still be there. And it was a school for child actors. So I had been out of school now for about 2 months. So I got a big assembly goodbye from the school. And of course the local papers had carried it that I had gotten the job for the show, blah, blah, blah. And the Western Union man comes with a telegram that says, pursuant to our agreement, they're canceling the contract. So that was a big deal when I was off the show. I mean, I felt so embarrassed. I'm in the fourth grade, and now I gotta go back to my school.
Oh, absolutely. And I want the kids to go.
But you know, it's a funny thing. When you're 10 years old and in the fourth grade, the kids don't care what happened. They don't understand what happened. And it was like I had never left. But I was like thinking that I had to go back to the school. I was like so embarrassed. You know, it was my first and only time in my life that I felt depression.
Oh.
Like I could hardly, that night I had like I was sleeping with a weight on me, you know.
Oh.
And but when I went back to school, everybody was just happy to see me, and nobody, who would have understood what happened, you know? Then I did get another part after that in another off-Broadway show, but then, you know what, I didn't want to do it. By now, I'm almost 12 years old, and I had had enough. You know what, I just want to play. I just want to play Little League and chase girls. That's all I wanted to do. My love for music stays. Now, though, it just becomes like, instead of me performing, it just becomes a soundtrack of my life. So now I'm growing up, and by the time I've finished with all this Broadway stuff, I'm listening to doo-wop. That's the popular music as I'm coming to age, you know. And when I'm in middle school, it's doo-wop is the popular music. And so that becomes the soundtrack. The touch of your lips, the thrill of your embrace, keep saying that no one. And then upstate New York, you could drink at 18 up there. And everybody would have fake IDs, so you were actually going upstate to drink when you were about 16. And they used to have the Cafe Agogo in upstate New York, and that's where I saw, before they became famous, I saw the Supremes, I saw Martha and the Vandellas, I saw Jackie Wilson. It was incredible. Oh, I saw the Miracles there. Oh, I loved them. And it was Ooh Baby Baby. I think that would have been around 1964. 64, 65. Yeah, Ooh Baby Baby, I'll remember that. Usually went up in groups. Usually the girls went up with girls and the guys went up with guys, and then you would meet, and that's where you would meet girls or guys. But it sort of wasn't like a date night. I can't remember anybody coming with a date. You know, you went there and hope you would leave with a date.
Yeah.
But you didn't go up there with a date. And so New York State at that time, because New Jersey's drinking age was 21 and New York's was 18. So New York State had all of these clubs that had all of these, you know, all it was part of a, it was part of the circuit for a lot of these up and coming acts. And then later on when I was in the service, my first couple of years in the service, I was really heavy into the R&B. So all of the Temptations, they were my favorite R&B group. It was the Temptations. Just My Imagination, My Girl. I got to see them in Superior, Wisconsin, which was the twin city to Duluth, Minnesota, when I was stationed up there in the Air Force.
As she passes by, I say to myself, you're such a lucky guy.
So then in the barracks is when I'm introduced to the sounds of jazz. Because remember, when you're in a barracks, your kids are from all over the country. You're hearing so many different kinds of music, because everybody had a record player in their rooms, you know. And so, I mean, you heard everything. You heard what the kids from the South were listening to, the West, the East, you know, the black kids, the white kids. It was like incredible, the sound of music. So there was a group of guys who were into jazz, and they were into like the funky jazz at the time. So they were, at the time, Wes Montgomery, who was one of the greatest all-time greats of the jazz guitar, he was playing a lot of popular tunes but doing them in a jazz fashion, so you could access them. Barracks weren't purposely segregated, you know, but most of the white kids were in one side of the barracks and most of the black kids were in the other side. I relate better with the kids who don't look like me, because I've experienced culturally or in music the kind of things that they had done. So once I did that, you can imagine I got even deeper into black music. Because now that's about all that I'm hearing. So then, when I would go to the Airmen's Club, the guys who played jazz were usually the band, and they would be playing the stuff. And I can remember then, and then it was Herbie Mann was another guy. He was a flute player, and he used to play a lot of funky types of jazz. And he was very accessible. So I says, you know, I really like this music. And so then I got the Downbeat magazine, I began reading about the music, and then they started talking about people who I had never heard of, and they talked about them in these glowing terms, like these geniuses, you know. And they talked about Billie Holiday, who I had no idea who she was. And I bought one of her records because I read an article that says she was just the greatest singer ever, you know. And when I heard her sing, I had that same feeling I did when I heard the first song I ever fell in love with. It was that same feeling as I got when I heard Danny Kaye and his daughter do Daddy Dear.
But God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own. Yes, the strong gets more, while the weak ones fade. Empty pockets don't ever make the grave.
And so I wore out that record in the barracks. And all the guys would come by and saying, man, who are you listening to? Who is that? And the record I had were cuts that she had done in the early 30s and 40s. So it was already, you know, this music was already 25 to 35 years old. And so now I was listening, I started listening less and less to R&B and more to jazz. And then I joined the Columbia, I used to have a record club, and I joined the jazz, you know, I was a jazz member, and they would send me new releases. So I would get releases from people I didn't really know any much about. And so they sent me a release of a Miles Davis record, and at that time, that was when he had the group with Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter and those guys. It was a great group, Ron Carter. But it was still a little bit too much for me to really, you know, to really understand. And later on, as your brain starts to get accustomed to listening to music in that way, I would revisit the records. I remember, I'll never forget, they sent me a John Coltrane record once, and it was called Ascension. And it was the free jazz. It was like nothing, music like I had never heard of in my life. Well, when I put that on, it made no sense at all to me. And I put it away, and it must have taken me about another 5 or 6 years before I could find that record as accessible to where I could listen to it and get pleasure. And then I was hooked on John Coltrane. And after that, I listened to everything that he made, and because he was my favorite musician and he played the tenor saxophone, I began listening to all the saxophonists, and so they informed a lot of my music. My style of singing was were all of these great saxophones. And in the meanwhile, I'm still listening to the great singers. But after about 10 years of listening to a lot of singers, then I didn't listen to singers anymore for about another 10 years. I just listened to instrumentalists. I'm feeling that there's no expression that's greater than the expression that was being found in jazz. That's how I believed it at that point. So I went headlong into it. So now I was into jazz and I loved the real modern stuff. And then all of a sudden I started looking backwards. And I started listening to stuff from the 1920s and 30s and 40s. Now I began, filling out my knowledge of jazz. But it was talking to me, and popular music no longer talked to me. My daughter was born while I was in the service. Then I got out of the service. And I went to college, finished my college at the University of Minnesota in Duluth. Then I went out to graduate school in Iowa. Now, I wanted to always keep music a part of my life, but I was convinced that you couldn't make a living at jazz, you know. So I wanted to study the sociology of music, because music doesn't occur in a vacuum, right? Music is, you know, it comes out of different social cultural milieus. But when I was at the University of Minnesota in Duluth, I was doing gigs while I was going to college. And there were clubs that you could play. But when I got to Iowa City, there was no jazz clubs. And so I had to make a decision. And then my wife lost her job. There was a very deep recession. She lost her job, and we moved to Milwaukee, where her family had been from originally. And I had made the decision that I wasn't going to be happy unless I played music. So I was going to just make music the center of my life, and I was going to have the kind of jobs that left me a lot of time to practice music and to perform when I could, and I would work to make sure that everybody, you know. There was money in the house and people had health insurance and there was money for a vacation, but it wasn't going to be like a professional job. So I did all these odd jobs that gave me a lot of free time. You know, I was, I read water meters for the city of Milwaukee. I exterminated income, low-income projects for the city of Milwaukee.
Oh, my God.
So I would do all these jobs that allowed me to make money, but gave me a lot of free time, even on the job, because these jobs that I had, you could finish it, you know, if you worked fast, you could finish your work. And there were some days where, you know, in 4 hours, I was done with all my work. So I could practice for 4 hours. Okay, September of 74, I arrived in Milwaukee. And Milwaukee had a little jazz scene there, because living in Milwaukee at the time was Buddy Montgomery, the brother of Wes Montgomery, who was the first real jazz artist that I started to really get into. And Buddy Montgomery was part of the Montgomery Brothers. There was also a Monk Montgomery. He played the bass. But all of these, they were from Indianapolis, which wasn't too far from Milwaukee. And so Buddy had a regular job at the Pfister Hotel, which was the best hotel in Milwaukee. And being a Montgomery brother, he knew everybody. But he was also he produced a lot of grant money. He knew how to get that grant money. And so you had all of these musicians coming up from Indianapolis who were, you know, nationally known people like him. And he was generating a lot of work because he would get the grants to play, you know, like I played with him at a psychiatric hospital. At a prison, and you know, he would get State Department tours, and so it was a really happening scene at the time.
Is there one song you can think of that you like really?
Was yeah, that dare to? the Bobby Ooh. Timmons tune, that dare.
That's my favorite song that you sing.
Yeah, that was my signature tune during my Milwaukee years. That was the signature tune. Yeah, that song, my arrangement, which I still use today if I have, you know, a group that's going to rehearse, because at that time it was nice. I mean, they were hiring groups. Clubs had the money to pay a group, so I would always work with the group so they could do, and that's what I finalized my arrangement on, that there. A lot of the arrangements I have was finalized in when I was in Milwaukee, because I was always working with a quartet. Hey daddy, what that day? And who that over there? And oh daddy, oh hey daddy, can I go over there? Say why that under there? And what day doing that? And daddy, can I have that big elephant over there? Say who that in my chair? And what he doing there? And oh daddy, oh hey daddy, can I go over there? Say daddy, what's a square? And where do we get there? And daddy, can I have that big elephant over there? My crazy gold kid, man, she doesn't want anything here. She's forever demanding to know who and what and how and why. So it really helped me a lot to, and we get together and we do a lot of jamming. And so there was for a town at that size, it was a healthy jazz scene. Now, you weren't going to make your living playing music in Milwaukee, unless you were maybe Buddy Montgomery, because he had that steady job at the hotel. But what was great is that if anybody who did a concert in Milwaukee always made sure that they would come to Buddy Montgomery. So, you know, you could be up there to see Buddy Montgomery, and Ella Fitzgerald would come in and sit in with him. But my time in Milwaukee was my formative years, and that was great because I got to do things. I opened for Grover Washington Jr. I opened for McCoy Tyner at the Milwaukee County Stadium. I sang the national anthem at Milwaukee County Stadium for a Major League Baseball game. I think it was a playoff game, because I know the other team was Milwaukee Brewers and Kansas City, and they were 50,000 people that day. And I did things there that I could never have done here. You know, because I was the only male jazz singer in Wisconsin. My time in Milwaukee was great, and there was a lot of growth, but there was just a certain amount of growth you could get there. And I say that because you didn't have the diversity of music like you have in a place like New York City. And so I felt I was getting like aesthetically stale. And so I said, you know, it's time to come back home. I'm really into this music, and New York is the Mecca. So let me come back and see what I can do in the city. So at that time, I met my wife-to-be, and we both left Milwaukee and settled in New York. And I started gigging in New York, and it was going well for a while. In fact, my first 10 years, I played only in New York. But soon, the money pressure started building, and I had to spend more and more time working at jobs that could pay the bills and leave something, a little extra for my family. So then it began, began to become a slog, So I played as much as I could. But it was a wonderful experience. I mean, when I hit New York, the first thing I did was to study samba music with the great Brazilian percussionist Guilherme Franco. I played in his Escola de Samba band for about 2 years. We would rehearse in the village and play all of the, we played for like was Halloween parade, and then we also played for the largest demonstration I believe that was ever took place in New York. Was about a million people for Earth Day. It was a demonstration against the nuclear proliferation, and that was a great experience. But those Brazilian rhythms were great because they informed my improvisations, my singing, and I couldn't have gotten that out there. Even in Chicago, where a couple of times I played in Chicago, which was really pretty hip too, but didn't have a New York head. I wasn't gonna be able to hear and do the kind of things and meet the kind of people that I would in New York, because New York had all the greatest players from all over the world. Everybody wanted to be in New York to see what they could do. So for the last 40 years, I've been playing all over New York, doing all sorts of things, and that's what I'll do until, the day that I die, I'll be singing. Because the great thing about being in the arts is this, is that as you get older, physically, you can't hold back for all the time. And physically, you're not going to be able to do things you could do in your 20s, 30s, 40s, etc. You're not going to be able to do those things. You're not going to be able to perform at a physical level like you did when you were younger. But with creative expression, as long as you work on your craft, it always gets better. You always improve. You grow over time. So while you're physically declining, you can still be creatively growing. And that's the beautiful thing about being involved in a creative endeavor. And that's where I am now. Getting older. Life's a losing game to me. Cares and woes I got me moaning. Every evening I'm a listen to that. Thank you.